Hi, I will talk about learning games, robustness of fast convergence, and this is a joint work with Dylan Foster, Ziyuan Li, Karthik Sridharan, and Eva Tardos. I will be interested in game settings where there are some selfish players that are interacting with each other. And such settings that we will be considering will be like routing games, auctions, and a broad class of other games. One example is that of ad auctions, advertising auctions. And if we look at this example, there are some interesting features that we observe. First of all, there are many players that are taking part in these games. Second, these games are repeated very frequently over time. There are many auctions that are happening at every second for each keyword. So agents can observe what happened in the past and can learn from this past experience in order to make more sophisticated decisions in the future and adapt their behavior accordingly. So as I said, I will focus in repeated games, and I will be interested in the efficiency of such games. And the measure of efficiency that I will be using is that of social welfare, which corresponds to the total happiness of all the participating entities in the system. I will be interested in price of anarchy type of questions, in the sense trying to measure the inefficiency that is caused due to the selfish behavior of the players. And essentially, the idea there is that we would like, ideally, to maximize the social welfare. However, what people try to maximize is their individual welfare. So the incentives are not completely aligned, and therefore there are inefficiencies that are caused. As a behavioral assumption, I will assume that players are using some sort of learning dynamics, and I will define what I mean by that in the following slides. And the main goal will be to understand how fast learning behavior converges to outcomes that are approximately efficient. Okay, let's go to some details. So I will assume that there is a stage game that is repeated over time. And this stage game, you can think of a normal form game with n players. For instance, a routing game. And each player in this game has a strategy space that I denote by capital SI. And in the case of routing games, you can think of the possible paths that he can use to go from his source to his destination. For simplicity, I will assume that all the players have the same number of strategies, and I will denote by D this number. So at this step, what the player does is that first, he selects a distribution of over his possible strategies. Afterwards, he samples an action from the distribution. And last, he incurs the cost that is a function of the realized actions of all the players. So in the case of routing games, he will decide the distribution over paths. He will sample a particular path. And afterwards, he will experience some delay based on how many people used its edge in the path. And as I said before, I will be interested in the social cost in this case, because I'm talking about the cost game, which is defined as the cumulative cost accumulated over all the players. I will be interested in repeated games. So I will assume that this stage game is repeated across time. And for the beginning of the talk, I will assume that it is repeated among the same participants. But throughout the talk, I will change this assumption also to discuss cases where the population is evolving over time. So the game is repeated in a capital T round. And players, as we said before, can learn can observe what happened in the past and can learn from the past experience how to behave in the future. In the beginning, they will be clueless. But after some time, they will realize what are the good paths that they should follow, and they can follow them. So the area generally of learning in games captures exactly such learning dynamics, so in the situations in which players learn over time how to behave. The classical notion that is used to tackle game theoretic problems is that of Nash equilibrium, which corresponds in the repeated game settings to a stable outcome that everybody has converged, and that this outcome, no player has to unilaterally deviate from the strategy that he is using. However, as Gailey said yesterday, there are many critiques for this notion. And one of the critiques that I'm mostly interested in is that decentralized dynamics do not generally converge to Nash equilibria. In some games they do, but in general games like auctions they do not. So an alternative notion that was later suggested is that of no-regret learning dynamics. And what this tells you is that players use a no-regret learning algorithm in order to decide which action they will use, which path they will take in the contesting game, for example. And if you're familiar with online learning literature, you should think of the experts of the online learning algorithm as the strategists of the players in the game. And in fact, there is empirical support for this behavior assumption in LastEC. Denis Nekipelov, Vasilis Irganis, and Eva Tardos showed that studied data from Bing auctions and showed that, in fact, the bids of the players can be rationalized as outcomes of learning behavior. And I guess Gailey yesterday provided some more supportive evidence about this assumption. Is that a good question? So I will recap a little bit what no-regret learning is so that we are only on the same page. So by regret, we usually mean the how good we behave compared to a fixed strategy in hindsight. So more formally, what it says, regret is the cost that we are having, the cumulative cost over time that we are having, minus what we would have had had we committed to any strategy, any fixed strategy in hindsight. And sorry? Correct. Yeah, it's just a typo. Thanks. If we committed to a fixed strategy in hindsight, and we examined the cumulative cost. So the vanishing regret property, that is the property that we are generally assuming in for learning dynamics, is that the expected regret is vanishing over time. That is that as time grows to infinity, the expected regret goes to zero. The average regret goes to zero. And the good news is that there are many common learning algorithms that satisfy this assumption. For instance, multiplicative weights, or also known as heads, or regret matching, achieve such a vanishing regret property. And in fact, they achieve that with a square root of capital T dependence on the time horizon.
Sorry, forgive me if this is kind of a standard question, but this regret as formulated could be negative.
Correct. That's even better for the. That means that I got an upper bound on what the regret is. If I do better than the best fixed strategy, I'm even. It's better for me, right?
So you grow linearly with time, right? Like it could be negative something linear in time.
Yes, but okay. I'm using that as a behavior assumption. What I assume is that the players will have at most regret square root of t. If they happen to find out that they can do better than the best fixed strategy in hindsight, better for them. They're still in my behavior assumption. What I want them is not to do worse. Okay. So one good news about the learning dynamics is that we know that, in fact, they do converge to efficient outcomes. And what I mean by that is that the expected social cost is at most lambda times the optimum plus an average term, plus an additive term that goes to zero as time goes to infinity. And lambda here corresponds to the price of anarchy of the game. So the no-regret learning dynamics converge to outcomes of price of anarchy of inefficiency equal to the price of anarchy of the game plus an additive term that goes to zero. And for instance, in the case of atomic contested games, I am assuming for the games that I am going to be talking, and this is the next slide bullet. I'm assuming that I'm talking about smooth games. Sorry.
Social cost.
Sum of social costs. Over time.
There's a summation over I of CI?
Yes, exactly.
Okay, so instead of
writing
CI,
yes. Okay. Yes, and, yeah.
Like that.
I'm missing a summation, so there is, it should have been average expected summation over time social cost. Social cost is the sum over all the cost of the players at time t. Okay. So, for instance, in the case of atomic congestion games with affine cost functions, this lambda is equal to 5 over 3. And this can be achieved by smoothness that was initially suggested by Ralph Garden, which is a unifying framework which includes a large class of games, like congestion games or many kinds of auctions.
Isn't it 5 over 2?
It's lambda is 5 over 2. Yeah, you're right. 5 over 3 and the one. Yeah, it's 5 over 2. It's 2.5. Yeah. Okay. Sorry. Typos. Typos. Thanks. So it's smoothness is a unified framework that captures many broad class of games, and you can prove if you can say that if your game satisfies lambda smoothness, then you can have the this guarantee. However, if we observe this guarantee, what it says us is that the average expected cost of summing over time is at most the lambda times the optimum plus an additive term. So if we look at this quantity, the whole guarantee is completely meaningless until the additive term becomes small, because else the additive term will outweigh the whole quantity. So, however, we know that no regret annealing algorithms achieve a regret of square root of t. So we can see that we can get a convergence rate of 1 over square root of t if we are using the vanilla and adversarial vanilla adversarial individual bounds for that. And the main question of main motivation of this talk is whether we can do faster, whether we can arrive to outcomes that are essentially the price of anarchy of the game in a rate of 1 over capital T. It's from smoothness. It's if the game it has.
Okay, so it's. I mean, where does this guarantee appear? I mean, which who showed it, or is it?
So it's a team Ralph Garden introduced the notion of smoothness, and then in Vasilis and Deva extended for mechanisms. This is from team and all of them. Generally, there is for a large class of games, there are. Such guarantees. The 5 over 2 that I said before is by Ilias Koutsoupias and Georgios Christodoulou. That's so, in fact, this question was asked before whether we can achieve fast convergence. And the partial answer that was given is that yes, but in specific settings and for specific algorithms. So, in the case of two player zero sum games, Daskalakis, Deckelbaum, and Kim, and later Racklin and Sidharan, showed that some specific, if all players use a specific algorithm, then they will converge to the so-called min-max value of the game in a rate of 1 over capital T. And later, last year, Vasilis Sirganis, Alec Agraval, Haipeng Liu, and Rob Sapire extended this result in the case of multiplayer settings, again showing that if all the players are using a specific algorithm, namely optimistic heads, then they will converge to outcomes that are efficient in the sense that they reach the price of anarchy of the game. However, all this previous work assumed that players are using specific algorithms and also assumed an unreasonable sort of feedback, because they assumed that at each round they get. They assumed that, that at this round they get access to expected utilities, taking expectations over the mixed strategies of all the other players, which is an unrealistic assumption because, first of all, it has information issues. You need to know the mixed strategies of all the other players. And second of all, it has computational issues, because even if you do know that, you need to be able to compute the expectations. So in this, the main result of this work is that, indeed, fast convergence to efficient outcomes is robust and calls for a broad range of algorithms and with more realistic form of feedback. So.
Because otherwise, I don't just the error of the
value. I will show you.
Just the value that you get from the
correct, correct. I will not say that I will get regret square root of t. I said that I will get a convergence rate of 1 over capital T to the to efficient outcomes. And I will, this, if you go at 3 slides, it will, you can ask. So the main contribution of this work is that first of all, you can, players can use a broad range of algorithms and still reach outcomes that are approximately efficient. And if the previous work instead assume that players are using a restricted set of algorithms. The second is that we assume that players have access only to the cost of the strategies taking based on the realized strategies of the other players and not having access to expectation feedback. And we also consider bounded settings. And last, these techniques are useful in the case when the population is evolving over time. And in previous work of mine with Vasilis Sirgans and Eva Tardos, we introduced the notion of dynamic population games. And we showed that if players are using some specific algorithms, then they converge to efficient outcomes even when the population is drastically changing over time. And in this work, essentially, we extend this by allowing them to use a broader class of algorithms, including multiplicative weights. So the main trick that we are using in order to do that is the notion of low approximate regret. So before going to low approximate regret, I will first repeat what is regret. Regret is the cost of the algorithm minus the cost of the best fixed strategy in hindsight. And there is a minimum instead of a maximum here. So the notion of approximate regret is a multiplicative relaxation of that. Essentially, instead of assuming that you will compare your cost to cost of the best fixed strategy in hindsight, you assume that you could compare 1 minus epsilon of your cost to the cost of the best fixed strategy in hindsight for some very small epsilon.
Cost. You sent 3 slides. It wasn't 3 slides.
Cost. Yeah, yeah. Costs are between 0 and 1. Okay. Okay. So the main idea of how we achieve that, and I'm going to the third slide, is that most no-regret learning algorithms achieve a regret that is epsilon times your cost plus log d over epsilon. And the log d over epsilon comes from a potential function argument, for instance, in multiplicative weights. But the idea now is, and usually in order to get the square root of t bound, you say that the first term is upper bounded by epsilon times t, the second term is log d over epsilon, so you can tune epsilon in order to make these two terms the same, and you get the square root of t. So now that we want approximate regret, we can just move the red quantity on the left-hand side, and then we will be left with an approximate regret that now is constant. And this will be the main idea why we can achieve the fast convergence of 1 over capital T instead. And the good news is that there is a broad range class of algorithms, including multiplicative weights, that achieve this low approximate regret property. And the other good news is that also the efficiency guarantees that we had before still hold for low approximate regret dynamics. Of course, now we move the epsilon times cost of our algorithm on the left-hand side, so we are having a small decrease in the welfare of the game. Instead of reaching an outcome with a price of anarchy lambda, we get a lambda over 1 minus epsilon. But you can think of epsilon as something very, very small. And instead, for instance, of 2.5, you will have 2.50001. And but now that you are having that, you are able to show that the learning dynamics will converge to the efficient outcomes in a rate of 1 over capital T. And it's important that it calls for a broad range of algorithms because, as I said before, we are using learning as a behavioral assumption. So we would like to allow the players to use a broad range of algorithms in order to decide what to do. Are there questions? I will now move to bounded settings. So, in the case of bounded settings, then the players just observe the feedback for the strategy that they ended up playing instead of observing full information, the feedback of everything. Unlike the full information case, where the main representative which was multiplicative weights, satisfied the low approximate regret property, the main representative of adversarial bandit learning does not satisfy that. The main representative is X3. And mainly the reason is that the regularizer that X3 uses is not strong enough to guarantee enough exploration. However, there are many algorithms that do satisfy the low approximate regret property. And in fact, in this work, we also introduce a new algorithm that is of learning theoretic interest because it provides an improved dependence on the number of strategies. And at the same time, it works for both costs and utilities. I will now move to dynamic population games. This is the setting where the population, the player set, is evolving over time. So in a previous work of mine with Vasilis Sirganis and Deva Tardos, we introduced the notion of dynamic population games, which can be thought as an interpolation between stochastic and worst case type changes. So what happens is that every step, every player tosses a coin, and with probability P, his type is changed. So when the change will happen is something that's stochastic. However, the types of the new types that are coming are worst case. So there's an interpolation between a stochastic and worst case type changes. Is this clear? So in a previous our previous result, we proved that the learning dynamics converge to efficient outcomes in such games, even when the population changes with very high turnover. That is, an almost constant fraction of the population changes at every step, constant with respect to the time horizon, with respect to the number of players. And we needed three things in order to be able to do that. We needed that each player satisfies log regret for shifting comparators. So what I mean by shifting comparators is instead of having low regret compared to a fixed strategy in hindsight, you need low regret compared to a sequence of fixed strategies. But crucially, you should have the low regret no matter how big the sequence is. And it will be worse when the sequence is bigger. And the second that we needed is the existence of a stable sequence of solutions for the optimization problem, where each solution is approximately optimal, and at the same time, the solution is stable. And what I mean by stable is that if you change the type of one player, then in expectation, the number of players that whose solution will be affected should be small. And in fact, we provided two ways to show such stability. The one way was by greedy algorithms, in which case, when a player changes, few other people are affected. And the other way was by differential private algorithms, where if one player changes, then everybody changes, but with low probability. And the last that we needed is that the game satisfies a generalization of smoothness, which is solution-based smoothness, which is can be derived by similar proofs with smoothness. So the behavioral assumption that I was assuming in this work is that players have low regret for shifting comparators. However, although there are algorithms that do achieve this guarantee, they are both complicated and there are also few. Usually, the arguments that we used in the previous work is that you should have small adaptive regret. That means small regret for each subinterval. And there are algorithms that do that, but there are not many of them. So in this work, we prove that low approximate regret, in fact, suffices and is significantly more common. For instance, it's satisfied by a minor modification of multiplicative weights. And I would like to spend some time now to discuss why this holds. So at every step of a multiplicative weight, what multiplicative weight does is that it says that the cost of your algorithm at this step minus the cost of the comparator that you're comparing against is at most epsilon times the cost of your algorithm plus one term that is a difference between two divergence terms. The one depends on the round t, and the other one is the same and depends on the round t plus 1. So the way that original multiplicative weights updates proof goes is that you telescope over the steps, and all the divergence terms apart from the first one disappear. And the first one, we know that we can bound by log d because we have a uniform prior. And hence you have an approximate regret of log d over epsilon. Essentially, when the comparator is changing, you cannot do the telescope across the whole horizon. However, you can do that for the window in which the comparator is fixed. So, and it's important that you do not need to know when the comparator changes, because this is just inside the proof. Okay, so for when the comparator is the same, you do the telescope for this sum for this time, and you are getting a log d term from the first term of its window. And I'm slightly cheating here because we do not know how to bound necessarily the first term of the other windows. However, if you put a minor perturbation at this step, then you can deal with that. And note, by the way, why it's trickier to get a low regret property here. So the low approximate regret property comes because the epsilon times cost will go just to the left-hand side. If you cared about a low regret property, then you need to tune epsilon accordingly. However, in order to do that, you need to know how many times the comparator changed. Else you will get a bound that is number of switches times square root of t, which is not good enough for our applications in order to get a constant turnover rate. So that's the main idea of why the low regret is more tricky than low approximate regret. To conclude, I talked about fast convergence in games, and I showed that the fast convergence of learning dynamics is to efficient outcomes is robust. It holds for a variety of settings and algorithms. In order to do that, I introduced the notion of low approximate regret. And this gave us the opportunity to prove that the fast convergence is ubiquitous. It holds for a large class of common learning algorithms, that you can just assume a more realistic form of feedback. You assume that you have access to the cost of your strategies based on the realized strategies of the other players instead of taking expectations. And we even showed the results for bounded settings. And last, we saw that this low approximate regret property proved useful in the case where the population is evolving over time, because it allowed us to extend the previous results that we had for a broader range of learning behavior. And this is again important because learning is, in our setting, a behavior assumption. So in order for our results to be prescriptive, we would like to allow players to use algorithms from a broad range of broad class. Thanks.